Excited to be back to talk about one of my favorite subjects, blue light control. And today I'm going to have a full breakdown of Pioneer blue light control. It's the format for the upcoming regional championships. Mine is early November. I know the one in the US is the first weekend of October. And I'm going to go over my card choices, how I would build the decks, a few different options you have, just also general deck building philosophies that apply to most control builds, as well as what Dustmourne brings, and going to some of the most popular matchups, as well as how it's sideboard in these popular matchups. So a lot to talk about, and I hope you enjoy it. So first up, the current list I'm playing. I've played maybe 15, 20 matches with this list now. I've really liked the feel of it. My results have been good, but not great. But overall, I like the list. I think it makes sense. Someone won a challenge when 901 Scarlet Storms past weekend was a very similar build, was one major difference, which I'll get into. And yeah, this is pretty close to where I started when I started playing Pioneer again after the bans. And I went straight to Temporal Lockdown. Or Temporary Lockdown, which is a card I had not played a ton with. I was usually more in the Portable Hold camp. I felt like Portable Hold was better against Phoenix because you get rid of the Shredder right away. I liked the pattern of being able to Portable Hold on turn three with a 2-mana counter spell up against something like a Blood Tithe Harvester. So in general, I've been in the Portable Hold camp. But the deck to beat was the new Rakdos aggro deck with all the Valiant cards, and I thought Lockdown would be really nice in that matchup. It turns out it was also that new Jon Food deck, which is one of the most powerful decks, and Lockdown is really nice against them as well in game one, and Lockdown still serviceable against Phoenix, especially since a lot of them play Prof's Idyllic Memory. I believe the card is called Enchantment, so maybe you can scoop that up plus a 2-drop. So not the worst there either. But first, I'm going to start with the mana base. I'm playing 27 lands, and I think I'm on the fence between 27 and 28. I don't think you want to go below 27. I used to play 26 back when I used to play Force Censor, but I think that was when the format relied a little more around Fable of the Mirror Breaker. It still does to some extent. But Censor, I find, is the weakest against the super aggressive decks with a ton of cheap cards. So typically that Rakdos aggro deck, and I think it's not anything special against Phoenix. So I made a choice to play less Censor. To make up for that, I added a land, and I think you could even go one more land. As far as the mana base go, nothing too weird, just free Field of Ruin to go with your five basics. You've got, I tried Fountain Port and I've kind of liked it. I have one castle, I have the channel land, I have a couple anchorage. I think the card's really good, but you don't want to go too crazy on coming to play tap land. And I tried once on Citadel and I've been really happy with it. So you can maybe even play a second one, but once again, you don't want too many lands to come into play tapped. All randomness, I guess, the one archive, one farmland split. I'm not sure if that makes a ton of sense. Couldn't decide which one was better. And I think it was, if I were to add land number 28, it would probably be a second farmland. Couple pathways and Deserted Beach, aka Tundra, in this deck. Really good in this deck. You have basically no 1-mana spell, so it's really hard to get punished for it. And when you choose which dual lands to play, one thing to keep in mind is obviously the number of each sources, but also if you have a lot of double whites and double blue in your mana base, that means you're going to need more of a quote-unquote real dual lands, meaning lands like Beach that can tap for both, as opposed to cards like Henge Gate Pathway, where you're going to have to choose early on, and then you might need the white early on, but down the line you might be missing your second blue, etc. So in this deck, that would be Pathway, and that would be Sunken Citadel too. So keep that in mind when you're counting your mana sources. As far as the spells go, the usual four No More Lies, a couple Vetoes, a couple Change the Equation, which is just exceptional right now. It's 2-mana hard counter in a lot of matchups. really solid cards. A lot of decks play Giganta, counters that. Obviously, counters Fable, which is one of the big ones. Counters Crackling Drake after sideboard against Phoenix. And just serviceable in most matchups. It's a little weakish in the mirror, but besides that, it's just really good counterspell. The one of Sensor, kind of my pet card, and didn't want to play land number 28, have an extra counter for Fable, which is nice. Also have one Three Steps Ahead. That card is good. I don't think you want to go too crazy with expensive cards, but the one-up is nice. It's nice to have that extra hard counter for the late game in some grindy matchups. Removal, I've got one Knot on my watch, one Gale Loss, and two March. I think March is the best one, and you see a lot of lists play three or four March. I wouldn't blame anyone for doing that. Knot on my watch is another one of my pet cards. It's a card you don't see a ton, but I just feel like it's the happy medium. You know, March can get clunky against Phoenix, having to pay three to kill a Shredder, or even five to kill a Phoenix. A lot of time you're gonna have to pitch a card, and I've been happy with that card. Maybe it's just fancy deck building syndrome, but I quite like that card. Gelos, I'm not a fan, but with Lockdown you can get rid of the maps, and it's nice to have the versatility. It's nice to be able to get rid of a Planeswalker in the mirror too. So just pretty solid card, I think, in small numbers. Yeah, the sweepers, I'm on the one Settle the Wreckage. I've historically liked that card in Pioneer. It's been good for me. I haven't liked it in every iterations of Blue White throughout the ages, but in Pioneer I feel like it lines up nicely. I like that it gives you that critical mass of exile effects against Phoenix, especially in game one when you don't have graveyard aid. I feel like to have a decent Phoenix matchup, you need cards like Settle, cards like Farewell, and the two Hollowed Moonlights, which can get Phoenix. They don't have the choice. If they play free spells, the Phoenix have to come back and you can get rid of them. So I think to have a decent, obviously the games can go well and you can win the games without these cards, but I like having some numbers of this type of effect. It could be something like Soul God Lantern in the main deck. And the main difference I was talking about between my list and what Scarlet Storms used to win the challenge is they were playing two copies of High Noon, which is the new enchantment, two mana enchantment. Players can only play one spell a turn, and then you can sack it for five, a red and four, to deal five damage to any target. But that's kind of was their answer to Phoenix in game one. I haven't gotten around to trying the card. Something that I just struggled to do when I'm building my deck, and having High Noon and Lockdown in the deck at the same time was a little too much awkwardness for me. So I haven't tried it yet, but I plan to try it when Duskmourn hits. These videos might not be like super structured, but I'll try to cover every topic I want to cover. So as far as Duskmourn goes, I'm not sure it's gaining a ton of new cards. There's a new dual land called Blood Farm Verge. It's that new cycle of dual lands. So the way it works is it always taps for white. And if you have an island or plains, it also taps for blue. So my plan was the new set hits is to switch to a portable hole version, try the new dual land. Really nice in this deck because that's what you want. You want untap white on turn one. And the Verge does that. The downside is that you probably need 12, 13, 14 islands and planes in your deck to make it tap for blue consistently. And right now, if you look at this list, it only has 11. So I think Pathway is an easy replacement for those. So that's two cards. And I'm not sure what you're supposed to do. You have two options. Either you just cut Deserted Beach, play four Verge, and then maybe make the last two Deserted Beach some extra dual lands, or you start trimming some of the value lands, something like the one Fountain Port, maybe the one Ottawara. Replace Ottawara was a basic, so it's going to be a little tricky, and it's going to take just a little trial and error, I guess. But yeah, that's my plan. I'm not sure there's a ton of other cards that are interesting. Maybe Ghost Vacuum, which is the one mana artifacts, exile a card from a graveyard if you tap it, and then you can pay six at sorcery speed to bring back the creatures you've exiled and their 1/1s. So, you know, bring back people's phoenixes or Crackling Drake up your sideboard. That card might be interesting as a replacement to Solgad Lantern. So I'll probably just at least try that card. One thing that might be nice for blue-white is some of the better cards are the new auras, and especially if you're playing Lockdown, seems like blue-white would have a decent matchup against Aura, and Enigmatic Incarnation also gets a lot of potential good cards with the new cycle of impending creatures that are also enchantments. They trigger up the Beanstalk, they're enchantments, you can sack them to Incarnation, and I feel like blue-white should do decently well against Incarnation. Typically, Farewell is strong. Narset can really shut down a lot of their cards. So I think the new cards from Dustworn shouldn't be a huge meta shift. And if there is, it should be decent for blue-white. So I'm guessing blue-white will still be decently positioned after the new set comes out. But yeah, that's all Dustworn talk. Back to the list. One card that's I used to not be super high on, and I started trying and been happy with it's Narset, Parter of Veils. One of the reason I wanted that card in my main deck is that the Lotus combo matchup is tough, and Narset can shut them down and gives you just a huge boost in a matchup. It's a serviceable card in a lot of matchups. It can be really good against Phoenix. It can also be awkward because if you tap out for Narset a lot of the time, they can tap out for Phoenix, attack it, and you haven't really gained much. But just solid cards, kind of a card you want between your main and your sideboard, and it's a card that does all something against everyone, even against an aggressive deck. It might find you one of your key 4 mana cards. They usually have to finish it off unless they can kill you because they don't want to give you a second hit. So it's like 3 mana impulse, gain 3 life, gain 4 life. That card can be nice. As far as card advantage, I win with the 2 Narsets, the 3 Deluge, and the 2 Teferi. I think this is a right mix. I might have started with 4 Deluge and less Narsets, and Wandering Emperor is your other win condition. Card advantage kind of does it all. Great card. The reason the deck is viable in Pioneer, in my opinion, and one of the reasons, Deluge is another one of it. So yeah, as far as the sweeper, I started with the mix of 2 Verdict, 1 Settle, and 1 Farewell. No Sunfall. The reasoning was that I wanted the cheaper sweeper against these Rakdos aggro decks. I also think that, especially after sideboard, Verdict is better against Phoenix. Having to rely on a 5 mana sorcery speed sweeper is rough. Verdict, where it works really well, was Rest in Peace as well against Phoenix. So yeah, that was my reasoning. Sunfall was a nod to Vein Ripper, and that was one of the reasons I stopped playing blue-white. I felt like the Vein Ripper, the Vamp matchup was really tough. It's not like Phoenix is ever a slam dunk. So yeah, once Vein Ripper got, or Soaring got banned, I guess, I felt like it might be a good time to bring back blue white control, and I thought it might line up nicely against the Rakdos deck. So yeah, this is the list I talked about. High Noon that you could play over Hollow Moonlight. I feel like that's a swap that makes a ton of sense. I think you could go, I guess the flex slots, as far as I see them, are Censor, Not on My Watch, Hollow Moonlight. If you got Not on My Watch, you probably want to replace it with another removal spell. The third Lockdown is a flex slot. The second Narset is a flex slot. You can maybe play a different mix-up sweeper, but you obviously have a lot of options. And then with the portable hole build, you obviously cut all the Lockdowns. You probably play 3 or 4 portable hole, let's say -3 Lockdown and -1 maybe Not on My Watch, or -1 March and just +4 portable hole, which might work better with Narset. Could even see going higher on Narset, since you have more cheap removal, better chance your Narset lives. So yeah, that's as far as the main deck goes. Sideboard, the newcomer is Besa, the Bounding Spring. That card has been really solid against Rakdos for obvious reasons, the gain life, the fish sometimes. The card, not very often, but yeah, it's been good. I will say sometimes they're actually on lower life total than you because they play Sulphur Springs and Shocklands as well as Ramnaph Runes. So keep that in mind. You have your own fountains, so you might actually want to shock it in some spots. But yeah, card's been super solid. I got the one flanker, which is a versatile card. It can come in against aggro, it can come in the mirror and Lotus. I've been trying it against Phoenix. I'm super skeptical. I always used to make fun of people for suggesting that card is good against Phoenix, but you know, I'm willing to try it. A little light on the Rest in Peace, only one and one Lantern. It's a card that I think is strong against Phoenix, but doesn't come in a ton of other matchups. And you know, they are on the usually young Pyromancer plus Crackling Drake playing after sideboard, so drawing too many Rest in Peace can be bad. There's also only so many sideboard cards you can dedicate to Phoenix. One thing you'll notice when you build the sideboard for blue-white is that you're going to end up with a lot of cards with Phoenix in general, and that's why there's, for instance, there's only one Dispute, there's only one Veto, there's only two Shark Typhoons, because there's just so many cards that are reasonable against Phoenix that are good in other matchups. So yeah, only one Rip, couple Shark Typhoons. I don't play them in the main deck anymore. I used to, but I think it's more of a sideboard card. Obviously, in people's main deck, they're going to have Fatal Push. A lot of time against Phoenix, it's actually a liability to make a Shark, because it's going to give them a target for their removal and help them bring back Phoenix more easily. That definitely comes up. So card that gets better after sideboard in most matchups. The one of Dispute, the one of Narset's Reversal. Originally, that card was for people playing Thought Distortion, which is not super popular anymore. Lotus combo usually plays Dromoka now, and it would pretty much only be the combo deck. I forget the name of the Planeswalker, the white-red Planeswalker. They might rely heavily on Thought Distortion, but the card is decent against Phoenix, serviceable in the mirror, so I still like keeping it in the sideboard. It's pretty versatile and gives you a little insurance. One thing to keep in mind is when I build my decks, I'm usually always keeping in mind that I'm going to be playing in open decklist events, which is not the case for everyone. So whether it's the regional championships or the Pro Tours are open decklist, and that's another reason why having Kahira, the Orphan Guard, is you know, I feel like blue-white control in general and control decks in general gain an advantage in open decklist, because in game one, you're not going to keep bad hands in specific matchups, as opposed to, you know, aggressive strategies. You know, you have lands and spells and creatures you're going to keep almost no matter what the matchup is, but, you know, a good hand, a hand that's good against Rakdos aggro, it's not going to be good against Lotus Field, and your cards are reactive, meaning you want the right reactive cards depending on the matchup. So I feel like you gain a little edge there. I think also knowing exactly how your opponent plans on attacking you after sideboard is more valuable for you than it is for your opponent in general. Especially, you know, blue-white control is a pretty known quantity. So, yeah. One card I used to not play a ton of in the sideboard was Aether Gust. I felt like it was, you know, nice and flexible, but not super high impact. And I'd rather have higher impact cards. But I think it lines up really nicely against the Rakdos deck. In general, Aether Gust is not great against a typical burn deck because their spells are really cheap. And sometimes they're even trading down on mana. But the fact that their deck relies on pump spells a lot makes a card like Aether Gust way more effective against them. I've also really liked it against Jaunt, and it's decent against the Lotus combo deck. It's nice that the stock list, as I said, plays the 6-mana white-green Dromoka, and that gives you extra answers to that card, which is a nice little bonus. So yeah, I really liked it. There's also a lot of Giganta decks, and I've had a lot of spots where I tap out to get rid of their board and they play Giganta, and then I untap and have that 2-mana cheap answer, buys me some time. Bird Veto, nothing to say here. You could even try to go up to 4, but that's another card that, you know, if you go up to 4 Veto, you end up with too many cards for Phoenix and maybe not enough cards in other matchups. The one Lantern, one Rest in Peace play, that might be another case of fancy deck building, a lot like the Not On My Watch, but whether you're playing against Grease Fang or Phoenix, you don't want to draw two Rest in Peace usually, because they can just win a grindy game with, you know, Chariot if it's Grease Fang, or just casting their creatures in Phoenix. So I like the split, and the Lantern is also nice for the mirror, where you wouldn't bring in Rest in Peace, but bring in Lantern, maybe you get a Deluge or two, can swing the game. And then Ashok is my hate card of choice for Lotus Field, it's maybe a little worse than Damping Sphere, but harder to get rid of. They have Bassage for Damping Sphere, and they only have Auto-Aura for Ash Shock. It's also decent against Nidalee. So I don't bring anything against Phoenix. You could. I think it's a little too clunky and expensive. But yeah, I guess the card I'd be really missing, and I missed in the challenge. Last challenge I played, I lost round one to the Lotus combo is Damping Sphere. So if you expect a lot of Lotus combo, maybe try and make room for a couple Damping Sphere. Maybe try and find, matchups where you feel like you have too many cards to bring in, or you don't need as many cards, and extra Damping Sphere is probably the best you can do. But Lotus Field is not super popular online right now. And I'm assuming one of the reasons is that Rakdos deck is probably a really bad matchup. Any deck that kills you really, really fast is a tough matchup, and they have Thoughtseize after sideboards. So that's tough. Also, the Phoenix matchup, which was historically really good for Lotus, has gotten worse ever since they got Pricklock Prankster. They get to play at instant speed and better, and they get to make better use of their counter spells. So I don't expect Lotus Field to be super popular, but if it is, it's definitely a tough matchup for Blue-White, and you might maybe want to trim the Ferret Base up for a Damping Sphere, or maybe it's tough. Maybe the Narcissus Reversal could go. Maybe the Lantern could go. But yeah, that's as far as deck choices go. Another card you could, we talked about High Noon. You could just choose to have it in your sideboard. Or have maybe one in the sideboard, one in the main, something like that would be pretty decent. All right. As far as matchup goes, let's start with Phoenix. Phoenix is a really close matchup. I'd like to think you're slightly ahead, but the matchup is tough to play. I think the biggest mistake I make repeatedly is to believe, especially in the sideboard games, that it's safe to start casting spells. And typically, one of the most common pattern that loses you the game against Phoenix is you play into their counters. You're like, okay, I'm gonna play a spell, end of their turn, I'm gonna untap, play another spell, and hopefully they don't have the counter. But what ends up happening is they have it, they untap, they cast a Treasure Cruise for one mana, and you've basically lost the game because your cards are more expensive, they're gonna snowball. And so I guess my advice would be, it's tough because every spot is different, but typically, if you're making land drops and they're not pressuring you, and maybe they might be missing land drops, you're not in a rush. You think you might be like, okay, I think it's safe to start casting spells. It's really not. They just play two counters, untap Treasure Cruise, and then you wonder where it all went wrong. Obviously, the other way is true. Maybe you play too passive and you start casting your spells too late, and then you die with a bunch of spells. The tricky part is, you don't have the info of your next three or four draw steps. So, sometimes you don't cast your spells and you end up drawing like three more action spells and very few lands, and you wish you had started casting your spells earlier. Sometimes you do cast your spells, they counter them all, and then you drop two or three lands in a row and you're out of action. So yeah. Just try to navigate these games as best as possible, but that is, like, I feel like the trickiest part of the matchup. As far as sideboarding go with this specific list, I would cut the one Get Lost, the three Lockdowns, one of the two Marches, one Farewell, and one 5-mana Teferi. I have been experimenting with leaving in all the expensive stuff, the Haymakers, the Teferi, and Farewell, but I don't think it's super wise. Get Lost in general, I like less after sideboard because the games get grindier and the maps have higher value. They're also really good at using them because of Pricklock Prankster, so they're almost always going to have a target for it. And Lockdown can be solid. A lot of lists play Young Pyromancer in the sideboard, and Lockdown lines up nicely against that. So you could consider keeping Lockdown in. It is a little awkward with Rest in Peace and Solgad Lantern. Ideally, if you cut all the Lockdowns, it would be nice to have access to a third Verdict. So, especially if you're someone who really likes Rest in Peace and you're playing multiple Rest in Peace, Verdict goes up in value. They work really well together. And, you might be a tiny bit light on sweepers if you do cut all the Lockdowns and you're cutting the Farewell. So, obviously, No sideboard guide is set in stone, but kind of general guidelines. I would cut these six cards, and then I would bring in Rest in Peace. I would bring in the two Shark Typhoons. I would bring in Dispute, Reversal, and Gust. That's six. Actually, seven was the Lantern. And what's my seventh card? Yeah, one Get Lost, three Lockdowns. That's four. One March. That's five. One Teferi, six. One Feral, seven. Cards you could consider cutting are maybe Sensor on the Draw or maybe Three Steps Ahead. What else? You can maybe trim a Wandering Emperor, even though they're nice answers to Crackling Drake. And I think they play better in the sideboard games than they do in game ones. So yeah, that would be my sideboard plan against Phoenix. Next is the Rakdos matchup. That's a new matchup. I found this matchup to be okay. Not great, but I do think you're favored. I've been doing fairly well overall. I'm not sure how Portable Hold versus Lockdown would influence that, but yeah. Note that Hallowed Moonlight stops the Kumano Faces Kakazan of flipping, so that's a utility, even though they do come out after sideboard. But my sideboard plan here would be minus two Moonlight, minus one Sensor, minus two Narset, minus one Farewell, minus one Teferi, and then I think I would cut Settled Wreckage. After sideboard, I think it's a card that gets worse. They get access to four Thoughtseize, which makes it a little easier to play around it. They also use the mana decently well. They have Giganta, they have Ramnap Runes, they have usually a couple of copies of Den of the Bugbear. So they use the mana well there. Even someone played Hazoret against me the other day, so that's a, even though I guess Settle is an answer to Hazoret, so that one goes both ways. But yeah, that would roughly be my recommendations, these eight cards. And then I would bring in Freebasa, the Flanker, the two Shark Typhoons, that's six, and then the two Aether Gust, these eight cards. You could maybe, cut the second Teferi, keep in Settle. I think Narset is, one off on the plays, maybe serviceable. On the play, you can maybe have the Sensor to help you hit your land drops, and it's a little more effective on the play, but that would be my rough sideboard guide for Rakdos. Next, a matchup is the new Jund Sacrifice deck. It's the old Sacrifice deck, except they play the black green 5-mana Ygritte card, and they have a loop with the cats that can do infinite damage, looping two cats. If they have Ygritte in play and two cats in the graveyard in play, they can start looping them. They also played the new Scavenger's Talent, I think it believes the one of the black talents to enable that combo. So I think this is, Sack matchup was always decent. I think this is no different. I think it's okay. I think Lockdowns line up pretty nicely. The Black Talent is kind of a break until it's not, so it's all slow to get going. And I think you should have an okay matchup, be slightly favored there as well. I haven't quite figured out how to sideboard. And one thing that's interesting is what to do was Lockdown after sideboard. The last time I played the matchup, what I ended up doing is when I was on the play, I cut Not on My Watch, I cut all the Lockdowns, and I cut Settled Wreckage. And the reasoning is that the way I envision the games playing out is me just wanting to use my cheap counters to just mostly counter their spells and then be somewhat proactive with my own Planeswalker or Cast a Deluge. And I felt like Lockdown would play awkwardly because you don't really want to let their spell resolve and then have to tap out for a Lockdown, and then maybe they punish you with a Fable or with an Onyxilis. I guess this is the other big part. The stock list right now boards in four Thoughtseize and brings in two of the 3-mana Onyxilis Planeswalker. And while that card can be manageable if you're keeping pace, it's also kind of scary, and I felt like Lockdown would be awkward against it because, usually they sack their creature and then they Onyxilis and all they do is start plussing it. Sometimes they'll make a devil first, but Lockdown doesn't really help you against that. Lockdown is nice against the Oven, Talent, all these cards, the tokens, the Harvesters, obviously. But I feel like most of the games you lose are either going to be to Fable of the Mirrorbreaker or to Onyxilis, and Lockdown's not the greatest there. So that was my reasoning. Obviously, in Open Decklist, you'll see what they're up to. They might also, added bonus is they might also overboard against Lockdown. They might think you don't board them out and have maybe too many abrupt decays or haywire mites, cards like that. So even though these cards, it hits for rest in peace and whatnot. But yeah. So as I said, what I did on the play was board out Not On My Watch, Settle, and all the lockdowns, and I brought in Rest in Peace. I brought in the two Aether Gust, I brought in the extra Veto, and I brought in one Shark Typhoon. And then on the draw, I think something you could do, for example, is Silcut, Not On My Watch, and Settle. Trim a Narset because you're on the draw, so maybe you have less time to set it up, and then maybe keep a couple lockdowns. So trim one, but keep two, and then you would bring in Rest in Peace, the two Gusts and the Veto, and then maybe not bring in the Shark. So it's kind of general guidelines for this matchup. Obviously, it's still new. I haven't played it a million times, like three or four times. So yeah, this is how I feel about it right now. Obviously, Portable Hole would change a lot of things, but feel free to experiment if you've played blue white since the bans, if you've played that matchups, or even if any opinions on other matchups, if you decide we're differently. A lot of it is great, but you might have like strong disagreements with some of the things I said. Please maybe leave a comment and let me know. That's cool as well. And then last matchup I'm gonna cover that's been popular, and I think blue white is well positioned. People like to play blue white, and I think that deck's gonna be pretty popular. So is the mirror. The mirror is, sideboarding is fairly straightforward. Basically board out all the sweepers, so the three lockdowns, the settle, the two verdicts, the farewell, that's seven. And you bring in flanker, two shark typhoons, dispute, reversal, veto, and lantern. So seven for seven. I don't mind keeping cards like Not On My Watch. The game's gonna come down to a point where people are attacking with Anchorage or Big Shark Typhoon. Maybe just keep it killing a Wandering Emperor token might do. It's not ideal to have Not On My Watch in your deck of your sideboard, but it's not the end of the world either. As far as this matchup goes, what I want to say. Oh, I want to just mention Narset's Reversal. A good way to use it is on your own spells, saving your own spells, or a lot of time maybe on one of their Dobbins Veto can be quite useful. But yeah, that's the deck. One thing I didn't talk about is Kahira versus Yorion, or even having Kahira instead of a sideboard card. I think Kahira is definitely worth it, even more so in open deck lists when they're gonna know what you're playing anyways. As far as the Yorion build, I was never a huge fan. I always thought you really failed the difference in consistency, especially with the Portable Hole when it was a different meta, but I guess now you have Rakdos aggro. But when Mono White aggro was pretty popular, or maybe Spirits was somewhat popular, really being to join to these early Portable Holes was key. Having more consistent draw, better mana draws, better mix up lands and spells. That's what having an 80 card deck does. It's gonna mean you're gonna flood a little more, you're gonna screw a little more. You're gonna, just your draws are gonna be slightly clunkier, and the format's aggressive, you're gonna get punished. The upside of Yorion is in the slower games and grindier games that are more about card advantage and less about tempo. Obviously, having that extra Yorion that can blink a Gnomon of the Sea is really nice. But yeah, I'm definitely in the Kahira camp right now. Once again, feel free to disagree, but that's not the deck. But yeah. That's it for blue white. I think I'm gonna try and make similar type of video for blue black control. I've only played blue black control a tiny bit recently, just a few matches. The Rakdos matchup seemed a little tough. I played one prelim, I lost round one to Rakdos aggro, and then beat three mid-range decks, so kind of part of the course. But yeah, I hope you enjoyed the guide. I hope it was insightful. If you haven't done so yet, please, if you enjoyed the content, of course, like the video, subscribe to the channel, leave a comment, all that good stuff. If you want to see more of me, I stream daily on Twitch, twitch.tv/yellowhat. And yeah, I hope you all have a great rest of your day, of your week, and I'll see y'all later. Take care, everyone.